The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome this Christmas morning. We're glad you can join in as we gather around word and sacrament. If you haven't done so already, you can set aside some bread and some wine beside your computer. And when we come to the Eucharistic prayers, the prayers of Holy Communion, you can join in partaking in the Holy Communion. Let's listen to and sing along Hark the Herald Angels Sing, number 270 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship Book. Let us pray. Almighty God, Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, born in Bethlehem. May we receive Christ into our lives and become through him your blessed children who walk in the light you have sent into our world. Through Christ we pray. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to John, chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light to all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We sing "What Child Is This?", hymn number 296 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship Book. Holding a newborn baby, or even seeing one from a distance in a stroller in the mall, or being held by its mother or father in the bus, it's not hard immediately to be taken in by, to have one's heart completely melted by, be immediately absorbed and captivated by the sight, the sounds, the smell of a newborn baby. Almost automatically, our hearts just tug with affection and with love for this little wonder of human life at the beginning of its Earth's journey. How can we not have our heart just tug with emotion upon seeing a newborn? I think God knew what God was doing when becoming human flesh and that of a newborn baby at that. It seems what God is most interested in when it comes to relating with humankind and creation is forging a relationship with us, with creation, based in love. God loves us and wants us to know it, to feel it, to experience it tangibly in the gut. And as a being of love, God wants us to love back, to have that reciprocal relationship of love. Ask any married couple or close friends or family, or even yourself, to describe, to articulate exactly what your love for the other is like. And I'm sure you'd have trouble being able to do it. It's hard to put to words those deep feelings, that deep knowing in the gut, love. But it's no less real or powerful. In coming to us in the flesh, embracing the materiality of our existence in the newborn baby Jesus, son of Mary and Joseph, God reveals God's heart, God's intentions, God's purposes, overall purposes, and that is to forge relationships of love. I think God is interested not so much that we know God in our minds as, you know, a rational, theoretical concept or an interesting idea or a philosophical object of examination grappled with in our minds, as much as that we love God with our hearts. God is more interested in us loving than thinking, I think. I like the story of the little boy who went to his rabbi with a burning question about God, saying that he didn't know how to love God. What does that mean anyway? What does loving God mean? And this invisible being in the sky, what does it mean to love this invisible being? How can I love God when I've never seen God? The boy asks. The rabbi looks at the little boy and says, well, start with a stone. Try to love a stone. Try to be truly present to the most simple and basic thing in reality so you can come to see its goodness, its beauty. Then let that goodness and beauty come into you. Let it speak to you. But start trying to love a stone first. The boy nods with understanding. But the rabbi goes on. He says, when you realize that you can love a stone, then go on to a flower. See if you can love a flower. See if you can be truly present to it and let its beauty speak to you and come into you. See if you can let its life affect you and give yourself over to that flower. You don't have to pluck it or pull it out or cut it or possess it or destroy it. You just simply love that flower in the garden over there. Love it. The boy nods with understanding. Then, when you think you can love a flower, then move on to your pet, to your dog. Try to love your dog. Be present to it. Pay attention to it. Care for it. Let its beauty and goodness move you and enliven you. Really, you know, really look into the eyes of that grinning, wagging tail dog. Love that dog. Just love it. The boy nods. Yeah. Then the rabbi goes on, try to love the sky. Look at the sky. Try to really pay attention to it. Be present to it. Let it speak to you and let its beauty, you know, affect you. Then, the rabbi goes on, when you're older, try to really love another person. be faithful and devoted and steadfast. Pay attention to that person. Care for her or him. Delight in that person. Enjoy, care for, pay attention to that someone. The boy nods. Yeah. The rabbi concludes, after you've loved a stone, a flower, a dog, a sky, another person, then, only then will you be ready to figure out how to love God. I think that's kind of neat. We learn to love God by loving what is and who is directly around us, before us, paying attention to the materiality of the world and universe and life right in front of us. Loving a stone, a plant, a bush, a tree, the sky, your dog, a person, people. We tend to believe in our, you know, in our rationalistic Western culture, heavily weighted to the use of the mind and logic. We tend to believe we can figure out God, theology, connect with God through our minds by merely thinking about the divine as a philosophical concept, construct in our minds, using our mental capacities, rational abilities to connect with the holy, totally unmoved by that experience, but happy to be exercising our rational capacities. But as the mystics of old would say over and over again, we know God by loving God from the heart. And we learn to love God by learning to love what and who is immediately before us and around us in the real world, in the materiality of our world. We pay attention to, as we do today on Christmas Day, we pay attention to an obscure, off-the-beaten-track cattle stall, you know, with cows and donkeys and wood and straw and the smell of a barn affecting our nostrils. We pay attention to those details, the materiality of it, and love it. Love it. We see if we can be truly present to the tiny, squirming, cuddling, crying baby in the manger. Pay attention. Be truly present to that baby and be moved by that child and by the promises expressed by the shepherds and Mary and Joseph and the Magi, who are all seeing the promises of God coming to fulfillment in the child that has been born. The child that has come to show the way, to defeat the powers of evil and to establish God's reign of peace and justice on the earth. I suspect that people with little or no patience for communing with stones and flowers, pets or human beings, or for that matter, cattle stalls and mangers and Bethlehem and babies and donkeys and sheep and starlit skies, will have no patience communing directly with God. But if we could learn to be patient with and pay attention and to love the real world before us, real people, real ordinary, multi-purpose, multi-faceted people from all over the world, loving real human beings, however different and unique we all are. If we can learn to love people, we can begin to learn to love the Creator of the universe, of all people. We can learn to love the divine. I think God makes it easier for all of us by coming to be a child, to be a baby, to come as a baby, a vulnerable, needy, lovable, cuddly, tiny child. Praise to God. Love has come down. And we sing Joy to the World, number 267 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship Book.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let us heart, prepare him room and heaven.
Let us pray. Living God, your Spirit calls your church to rejoice in Christ's birth. As we gather at the manger, help us see your face in all babies needing comfort and care. Equip the church in the nurture and encouragement of all children. You are a God of joy. The rocks and the streams proclaim your praise. Attune us to the joyful sounds of your creation. Stir us to tend the earth wisely, that the whole earth may dwell in abundance and in peace. You are a God of truth and of justice. Your messengers declare your joy to the world. Embolden leaders and nations to make your justice and peace known throughout the earth. Uphold justice advocates and social service providers who risk their safety to help others. You are a God of infinite compassionate love. You choose those regarded as lowly to tell the good news of your love. Pour out your mercy and your care on all who are sick and grieving, struggling, and the elderly who live alone. Pour out your mercy and care on all those who struggle with their mental health. You are God Emmanuel, God with us. You abide with your people in times of trouble. Accompany families and children who have nowhere to turn. Strengthen us to care for those fleeing danger, abuse, or neglect. Give all resilience and creativity, courage and peace in the midst of our fears and uncertainties in this pandemic. You are an eternal God. Your grace and mercy extend to all in all times and places. Give comfort to those who mourn and assure them of the peace that you have granted those who have gone before us. Rejoicing in your word made flesh among us, we commend all of our prayers, both spoken aloud and whispered silently in our hearts, confident of your grace and your love made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. To those of you now at home, have your bread and wine close at hand so you'll be ready to drink and eat and partake at the appropriate time in our prayers. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your Son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples in whichever language or version you prefer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. we listen to and meditate upon and sing along What Feast of Love, number 487. The God of hope, fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit through Christ Jesus, the Word made flesh. Amen. Go in peace. Rejoice in Christ our Savior. Thanks be to God. We sing Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 290.
Shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by.